Have you been finding the podcast, G?
I don't know, G. I hate the sound of my own voice, so...
That's everyone, though.
I don't listen back to them.
Just when you're editing it.
Yeah, bro. And, like, the first one, I barely edited. The second one, I kind of edited. But the first one, I was swearing heaps, bro. I was like, fuck, surely I don't swear that much.
Bro, I just thought the same thing when I just did my last one with Tahu. I listened back to it, and I was like, oh, too many B-words, man.
Yo, because I've seen your comment on your Instagram post. You said the main caption, and then you're like, oh, excuse the language.
Yeah, bro. I ended up taking it down, eh, because...
Oh, yeah? Yeah. I thought so, G, because I was trying to find it on my drive home today, and I was like, I kept refreshing your Spotify, and I was like, I can't even find it.
Yeah, I'm gonna go through it and edit it a bit and then chuck it back up just because the language is poor, eh? Don't like it.
Yeah. But no, I don't mind them, eh? I find them real good, bro. They're a really good, like, escape for me, like, after work or, like... something to like totally take my mind elsewhere.
That's something different, eh?
That's buzzy, bro. And like, I reckon it's a skill, eh?
Definitely.
Podcasting, bro. It's a skill. Like, you always got to be on the right topic to keep your listeners just engaged.
Yeah.
Like, it's a skill, bro.
And to like be able to like keep talking. Bro, but to like even to be able to keep talking for like, you know, like and just keeping yourself like on a roll, like that's pretty hard, G.
Yeah,
almost like speaking, bro.
I know. Another thing that I'm pretty dumb at.
good choice on the tee, bar.
Oh, but I didn't even think, G, because I was wearing this morning and I like just got home to unpack my shit and I was like, oh, all right.
Yeah, let's go. Speaking of advertisement, if you haven't jumped online already, www.138.co.nz collection 3, baby. You got you one of these?
Nah, not yet. What are they like?
Yeah, I see, no.
Do you have any? What size is that?
XL.
I'm not wearing a double X, eh?
Oversized, though.
Yeah, oversized, baggy gang. Not to one up you, but.
you got the corduroy cap, eh? Is that right?
Bro, on God, like, I was thinking about it on my drive home today. I was like, this is probably the best fitting hat I've ever had that, like, fits my dome. Like, brotherhood. Like, I reckon they fit my head, like, better than New Era. Because I reckon New Era... Probably. How many New Era hats do you have?
One.
Oh, because I've got like, maybe three or four. And they kind of all fit my head different, even if they're on the same, like... the same snap on the back.
Yeah.
I like the fact that that's like corduroy one.
Yeah.
Like corduroy's gangs. The fits, the, like every angle just makes my dome look way prettier than what I actually am.
this is getting clipped onto the gram bar.
I just like it way better, bro. I thrash it. And your beanie of like, bro, that's the other thing, G. Like the main thing that I like about them is because it's, like your business, it just has like that extra little bit of meaning, you know what I mean?
Yeah, like, I exactly know what you mean, bro.
100%.
I exactly know what you mean, bro.
What's your new setup like at the garage?
It's not too bad, G. Just got the light going on.
Well, not the footy light, bro. That artwork's gangster, bro.
A little bit more space, bro. So I'm gonna try and get one of those roadcasters. I'm just looking into it now. It's like a it's like the soundboard, bro. You just like sit it for podcasting.
Oh, yo!
Start recording.
They, like an audio mics. Interface type thing.
Yeah, basically audio interface, and you is just plug like your mics in. Yeah, bro. Yeah, and bro, the mics that go with
intro
it.
Intro is dope, eh?
Oh, I know.
I know because I listened to your one with him.
Yeah.
And at the start, I just remember you just buzzing out, just like barred up down south, just stiffy on.
Let's go! Stoked,
bro.
Yeah.
Bro, it just suits him so well, eh?
Yeah, I know. It was such a hissing song, like when I
don't even know that song, well. Dude. You know, what's the song?
It's by Ethnic Roots. I forgot what it's called. I've got it on my playlist. You know how
I remember, like, one day I had an idea that I was keen to make a potty.
I was driving Babylon Hunt, my, before I forget.
Babylon. And I was like, oh, I reckon that'd be, like, it'd be cool to make one. And then I remember listening to your one on how to make one. So I listened to it again. And then, like, the next day, G, I was, like, pretty much all set up.
Yeah.
Like, dope process, eh? And, like, it doesn't... The other thing is, bro, is, like, it's not, like, heaps of admin.
Yeah.
Like, that's not much to set up.
That's what's so mean about podcasts, bro. Especially if you're not... But I want a video because I love the video form of it. But if you're not doing video form, bro, if you have something like the Roadcast, or even if you don't, you're doing it, like, on GarageBand or whatever. So easy, bro. Record, end, like, export, 100%. On.
Bro, because I went to the music shop on K Road today with Laura.
Oh, you went to the music shop.
I went up to the bro. I was like, bro, hit me up with a USB mic.
Yeah.
You know, like, oh, bro, all this went straight over my head, bro. I was like, I don't even know what you're talking about.
Is this the debut
of the mic?
Yeah.
Hans, G, look at this, G. Dang, humble beginnings. I was gonna get like a stand.
Yeah.
Stand. I was gonna get a stand there, but nah. Bro, this is like $180.
Yeah, that's
like just, it's good quality.
Yeah.
And stuff like that. But
no, they're not cheap.
He was like, you want one of those, what was that thing that you called? Like an audio interface? What's it called?
Roadcaster.
So he showed me a little one, like a small one, bro, like yay big.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Just get this, looked at the price, $250. Oh. Yeah.
Like, that's actually not bad compared to the Roadcaster, bro.
True.
They're 1100, G.
Ick. I saw the price. He's like, this is probably what you need. I looked at him. I was like, put your head in. My body's on. Put your head in. My body's on that mean.
Humble beginnings.
Oh.
But you should have hit me up first, bro, because I was going to sell these, when I got that new one.
Oh, true.
These are two good USB mics, bro.
Do you have two of them?
Are you
getting new ones?
Yeah.
What did you get those for?
For this, but I'm getting new ones because if I get the Roadcaster,
then you need, like, proper mics.
Yeah, you plug the ones with not that aren't USB, and bro, this fucking such good quality of the Rode pod mics. Anyway, wait, let's get into this because we're having too much of a corridor and a catch up. Welcome back to the 138 podcast. I'm here with my boy Ran. Obviously, we've done a podcast together, but I guess we decided together due to what's going on in the world to take that down. Because Rani's in the police force, we had a few stories to tell around his experiences in the police, and we thought it might be a bit sensitive, eh, bro?
Yeah, but just touching on that, though, I'd be pretty keen to kind of cover that stuff again, but probably, obviously, with a little less detail and stuff like that, because there's some good learnings in that stuff for everyone as well, bro, that I'd be 100%. pretty keen to do another
one. And if you want to hear, like, I listened to your... I think it was I listened to both your first and your second podcast, bro. Everyone that doesn't know, he's just started his own podcast, Always Loved. And you talked a bit about it in one of those, eh? A bit about
being involved, only a little bro. Bit, though, but it's probably, there's so many stories to tell, bro, that it's probably fitting to have it in just one epi
on its own. Yeah.
But there'd have to be a lot of, like, maintenance and stuff trying to cut out bits that shouldn't be in there.
Let's... obviously, we've got this podcast today. We're going to talk about Schoolboy footy. I chucked up a bit of a question on my Insta page, asked what people wanted to see. Someone mentioned experiences in Schoolboy footy. And I knew we were supposed to get on a bit of a potty together. And I thought, this would be a good one to jump on together and have a yarn since, 100. You know, we have a bit of experience together and against each other in Schoolboy footy, bro. So,
yeah.
First of all, give your background on the old Schoolboy gig.
Schoolboy gig. All right. Year 9 to year 10, I was in Palmy. I played under 15s,
little bit of second 15 for Tutor. That's a whole other story, but that's kind of where my schoolboy footy kind of started, and that's kind of where I was always keen to make schools. It was kind of when I was still a grommet, year nine, bro, and that's the main goal that I set myself. And it's in the end of year 10, we were playing in a an under 16 Hurricanes tournament. We played in Ruatoria, bro, at the back of Gizzy. So there was like, Manawatu, Wellington, Hawke's Bay, East Coast, Poverty Bay, like all of these teams under 16s. And that's where I got picked up for a rugby scholarship to Kings.
Yeah.
So me and Eddie, we're in the Manawatu team. So Ty and Sis, to kind of put it in context for all the listeners who don't know who Ty and Sis are, they're Ty and Sis LaVere. So they're brothers, pretty tidy footy coaches for their own name. They're twins and they both went to St. Kent's. So Ty coached St. Kent's, which is where Loss went, and Sis coached Kings, which is where I went. And that made for some pretty good battles. But so I was lucky enough to get a footy scholarship to Kings for 3 years, year 11, 12, 13. Year 12 made the New Zealand Schools Barbars team. We had some pretty good footy names in that team. And the schools team that year was packed. And then obviously the last year, you and I were lucky enough to make the New Zealand Schools team, bro. So in a nutshell, that's pretty much it. But there's a lot of highs and lows and a lot of blood, sweat and tears in between all of that. But that's pretty much in brief my schoolboy footy experience here.
Bro, that last part you just said, eh? Fuck. That is the most emotional footy you'll ever play.
It is, bro. And like, funny that this is the topic, because on the weekend just gone, on Saturday, I went to the Kings Grammar game.
Yeah.
That was at Kings. And that was the first Grammar game I'd been to since I played in our last year, 2016. And bro, it was just like, you could just feel the whole emotion and atmosphere, eh? Like, as soon as you walk through the gates, bro, like, it was the exact same feeling as the one that I played in. Even more so, like, even more important. And it's just like, it's the be all and end all, bro. Like, that's the biggest game of your life that you've ever played up to that date. You know what I mean? Like, schoolboy footy, 1A, it's the best competition in the world, bro, for schoolboy footy, in my opinion, 100%.
And it's almost like even more personal because you know, like, let's say you're playing for like Wellington or you're playing for Taranaki or something like that. You're representing, you know, the region and things like that. And that's all like sort of well and good. But when you're representing your school, it's like, you know, everyone in your school, you go to school with them, you see them every day. And so it's like,
that's it, bro.
It feels more like you feel more of an emotional connection, you know, because you're like, bro, you're representing people, you know.
Yeah, that's it, bro. And like, you're in class with these people, eh? And like they play under 75 kgs on a Saturday morning, 10 o'clock. And then they go home, get into their number ones, and they come back to watch you play at 2:45, you know, like that's the culture. And from Monday morning, your first class with them, to Friday afternoon before captain's run, they're just hyping you up, bro. They're like, fuck, I can't wait for this game. How do you feel about it? Like, they're just G'ing you up, bro. Like, they don't know it, but they're G'ing you up for, like, the biggest game of your life. 100%. And then, like, you see them on the sideline. Oh, bro, they do, eh? And, like, especially, like, what do you guys call when they, like, paint each other blue and shit? They all look like Smurfs and shit, eh?
Yeah, pretty much, yeah. Everyone just
That's hype man, bro. Blue. That is OG, real hype man.
That's hussing, eh?
Yeah.
I just love how...
I miss it, bro.
I know, so much, bro. Yeah.
Like, some of the best footy you'll ever play.
What is the best... What's the best game you recall? Probably one of the grammar ones, eh? Surely.
Yeah, bro. My best game... Sorry. My favourite game that I'll always remember will be being in grammar in my last year of school. We had a gun team... we were down and out, bro. We'd lost. I think we played you guys the week before. We'd lost. We had a predominantly year 13 team, so we're quite old. Like, it would have been a completely different team the next year. We were at home. Like, it was just meant to be, bro. And we just ended up, because we were in pretty shit form at the time, bro. And we ended up winning. And it was just one of the best feelings, bro. Like, the best feeling was being up, knowing there wasn't long to go. And like grandma were on our halfway, they threw a pass, bro, in like the tram lines, and they knocked it on, and AJ picked it up, bro, scooped it up with one hand, and that mammoth of a male, bro, just started sprinting. Bro, and my man was sprinting to the goal line like, you, bro, I can just, like, bro, I can literally see the whole crowd, like the Kings crowd, just bouncing up and down, just watching AJ sprint, because he was golden boy there, bro, like, yeah. Everyone loved that man, and like, we all just embraced him, and like, if there was one person that you wanted to see hit someone else from King, it would be AJ, bro.
Bro, you know the biggest... that
from AJ on Saturday.
The biggest thing I remember from AJ, bro, there was this one time we were playing you guys at your school in year 12.
Yeah.
And the EU's beat us. And I put up on, you know, where your the side of the field your guys fans stand on. Yeah. And I put up a boxy, and he was standing back. It must have been off a kickoff because he was standing back. And he caught it. Someone else jumped for the ball as well, but missed it. They like contested, and he caught it and came down. And our guy had already passed him because he had contested for it. And then he had open space down the sideline, was running down the sideline. And I was standing there pretty much by myself, bro, because he had run past the line.
Yeah.
Not only was I looking at one of the biggest, blackest fillers in schoolboy rugby or that I had ever seen, and those quads, bro, they were like bursting out of his shorts.
Eh?
And your whole crowd, bro, down that sideline, because he was running down the sideline that your crowd was on. And they were like, get him, go, run him. Like, they're just,
bro, that's the thing. Like, it's one of those things, like, when you see someone catch the ball, and you see someone pass AJ the ball, they're automatically standing up, bro. Like, they know something's going to happen. Yeah. You know, that's how special he was.
Mm.
Like, he's one of the most freakish. He's, if not the most freakish athlete I've seen at schoolboy level rugby, bro. His body composition, for one, the power and strength and speed of that man, bro, is next to none. I've never, ever seen anything like it. And I don't think we will, bro, because that man... like, you've seen before with his shirt off, bro. Like, that's illegal, you know? Yeah. Like,
That's steroids, eh?
Bro, I remember telling him, because him and I used to be in the same boarding house, and him and I used to live right opposite each other. And I was like, bro, how are you so big? And he goes, oh, you know, like, growing up, I used to do, like, 200 push-ups a night and, like, four lots of 50. Bro, I can't even do 50 push-ups without stopping. I was like, yeah, I'd start four sets of 50. Fucking bro. I was like, that is, like, honestly, bro, like, but he's flexible with it. Like, he was, if not the most flexible person in the team as well.
True.
Yeah, bro.
They reckon there's a massive connection between flexibility and the best athletes in the world, eh? Massive connection.
I wouldn't be surprised, eh? But all I remember, bro, is just seeing him just gun it. Like, it was just so fitting, bro, because he was just, like, the face of our team, pretty much. Mm. And just seeing him, like, holding the ball in one hand, like, just, fuck, it was awesome, bro. And his massive dive, like, you just knew that would win the game. And the whole crowd was just screaming, like, chanting, bro, like, who's getting on the piss tonight? We're getting on the piss tonight. Like, no, shut up. But, bro, like, just scenes. And you would have had, like, heaps of cool moments like that, bro, throughout your school with footy, because your career was pretty successful, eh?
Yeah, bro. But I was just watching a video before of the Grandma Kings game. That was it, just last weekend.
Yeah.
Did you end up going to it?
Yeah, that's the one.
I was watching a video of the haka, bro. And gee, like, you know, it's been what, 2016 was our last year at school.
Yeah.
Pretty disconnected with schoolboy rugby now, and. Yeah. And I saw that video pop up, bro. And I almost, like, got, like, watery eyes, because it was just, like, how, like, much passion and stuff that these boys... And, like, they're just... You guys... Because I want to ask you what this feels like for you. Because, like... Because since you were actually involved in it. So, like, St. Kent's, we don't do a haka. And we don't have a, you know, like, a fixture that... you know, that fixture, how big your guys was with Grandma. And you guys used to stand at the front and your whole... like boarding house, whatever, was behind you doing the haka for you, behind you. Bro, what does that feel like, dude? Just to, like, stand there and just, like, have it roaring from behind you.
Oh, bro, I remember my first ever one. So I was year 11. I had to close my eyes, bro. Otherwise, I was just getting too overwhelmed with it.
Yeah.
Like, I tried not to actually listen to any, like, any huckers.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I just would have been too emotional, bro, and, like, it just would have affected my mindset. But later on, like, the second year and the third year, it's just this whole feeling of, like, you walk out there knowing that you're facing a good team. So, you're, like, you're confident, I reckon I'm going to beat these guys. But you know how you always say that thing in the back of your head, fuck, they've got some good players. Like, they could hurt us here, they could hurt us here. But, bro, hearing, like, the school behind you, back you, just puts you on another level, eh? And you're like, fuck, these guys don't stand a chance against us.
Yeah.
You know, like, that's the mindset it puts you in. You're like, these guys are toast, bro. These guys need to get off this field ASAP. You know, like, that's just the mindset it puts you in, bro.
Reckon it's so mean when, like, they come off and they, like, come around you and stuff as they're running off. Like, I was just like, fuck, that's mean.
Bro, and I still remember when we won against Grandma my last year, like, it was spoken to, like, at the assembly, bro. On Wednesday assembly, we have, like, a certain segment about the Grammar game. Like, this is where you
I heard this on your podcast. What happens
at the end.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. And, hectic, bro. Like, they're like, if we win, you have to stay behind the gates, bro. We won. And, like, the gates were bent, bro. Like, people were just putting that much pressure on. The gates were, like, on an angle because everyone was just trying to push and get onto the field, bro. And then the teachers couldn't stop it and just the whole school was on the field, bro. Just, like, it was wild. Yeah, some of the best memories, bro, I'll never, ever forget.
Yeah. I remember.
The thing is, bro, like, there's quite a lot of people that go to those games. But because St. Kent's have been so successful, you guys, like, have big crowds almost every week. You know, like, it wouldn't be rare for you guys to have 2,500-3,000 people at your games, I reckon. Especially when you play, like, Mags.
I reckon the big schools. Like, when we were playing smaller schools, it looked like a completely different ground, you know? Like, when we were playing someone, like, that, you know, that we were supposed to beat by, you know, like, we're supposed to win comfortably, we would have no one turning up to games, bro. So, like, it was this massive contrast. But, like, there were some games where it was, like, the 1A final that same year in year 12 when we won it. That, like, probably still today is the best, like, rugby game I've ever been a part of, bro. Like,
really?
Because we was at Eden Park.
Yeah.
And they were like, the way they set it up was, because Eden Park can hold like 50,000 people, whatever it is, something stupid. They only opened up the stand that you look at when you come out of the tunnel. That's the only one that was open. And half of it was set for our school. And then there was this massive thing down the middle. And then half was set for the other school. So they couldn't, like...
That's good, bro. That would cause fights.
Bro, yeah, exactly. That's why it's, so they separated them and they were just chanting at each other like the whole game. And so, like, we turned up, we go down that bus lane down the back at Eden Park, come in the back, get changed, and the boys get warmed up behind the field or behind the stands. And I come out of the, because it's like obviously on Eden Park and it's a little bit different to your like usual warm up and stuff, like the boys had to warm up out there. But if you wanted, like us kickers wanted to practice our kicking before the game, we had like allocated time slots. So like, so I had like 15 minutes from a certain time to a certain time where it was my turn to go out on the field and kick. And then 15 minutes after that was the other kicker's turn to go out wise.
Really?
That's I went out there, bro, walked out the tunnel and I didn't realize at the time that I was going to be the only person on the field. And the whole school's already there, bro. I think there was like something like 13,000 people at that game. And that's pretty much all of them were already there at this time. And I walk out and I just heard one person like yell to me, like must have been one of my mates, like Carlos. And then like just everyone was yelling because like it's probably the first person they've seen come out of the
tunnel. Yeah.
And then I was like, I just looked up and I just went, looked and I was like, holy shit. And I just looked down and I just walked and I was just like, just trying to breathe. I was like, this is so overwhelming, bro. Like, I've never played in front of this many people ever.
Bro, like, and like, how old are you? How old were you then?
16. Yeah.
What other 16-year-old experiences something like that? Eh? And then you have like the freaks like May. May was like 14 when he experienced his first
bro.
You know, like, that's an anomaly, bro. That kid.
You don't realize, hey, you don't realize how young the boys really are. Like,
I know, bro. And like the way they play and like carry themselves off the field. You would never think that they're still at school, bro.
Yeah. I know what you mean, bro. Especially just, even now, like he's what, just turned 21, bro, or something. Or he turns 21 this month. Like what? Chico, maybe he's 20. Like that's just stupid.
But bro, the other thing is that I was going to touch on when you walked out. Was it better for you knowing that you'd experience, you'd embrace that whole atmosphere before actually running out? So you'd been there like 15 minutes kicking, you knew what the vibe was like, so it kind of gave you the upper hand when you ran out?
Yeah, maybe. Played? I actually reckon, so like I developed a really good thing at Kent's where, and I owe probably a lot of it to Ty. I was always sort of like this, but like, Ty sort of really developed it in the boys a lot. And it was like the being able to enjoy the emotional side of things. And like, so like when we, obviously when we get let out by the bagpipes. When we play at home, we go down our sideline where all our players are, or where all our school is. We go down that sideline and we walk along that sideline and they're all screaming at us. And he would always say like, enjoy that, like love that. Like that's feel so that emotion, but then he always made sure like, but once you're on the field, once you cross the white line, you switch. Like it's like you go 100%. From enjoying the emotional part to once, as soon as you get on the field, we used to come in. I used to always say this, like pretty much every big game, I'd say this. I'd like get the like we'd be in this little huddle, and I'd just like step in the middle and be like, "We're out here now. Nothing outside those white lines matters anymore. Like we are here. Like." This, we're here to play footy now, like cool heads. Now we chill. We enjoyed that. Now we chill. And like, cause like you said, bro, cause footy, schoolboy footy is so emotional. Like it's hard to.
It's led off the back of being emotional, bro. You think of school rivalries, like old boys who are like 70, 80 years old still hold that. Like, we'll take King's Grammar, like King's Grammar.
Mm.
Like 80-year-olds still hold on to that rivalry, bro. Like that's stuck with them for life. You know what I mean? Still like turn up, that's emotion, bro. It's all emotion. And to be a part of it is just wicked, bro. But man, we took it real serious, eh?
Yeah. So obviously like we always yarned about this shit, like at school and even after school. Like, do you think like, cause I even know like, you know, we're talking about the big smoke right now. We're talking about our experiences in Auckland where, it, you know, it's probably a lot different to a lot of schoolboy situations. Like, and we'll go back and we'll touch on that as well. But like, do you reckon it's like for myself, I know that I definitely had, you know, those big ups, but I also, you know, there was potentially a lot of things about it that were probably negative to like me being, you know, me being a young boy and, like for example, like you just said, everyone takes it so seriously. Like we would like in year 12, we had this rule, like there was no drinking during the season, that sort of stuff. And I'm not saying it's not a bad thing to not drink during the season, but like we were like treated as professional footy players, bro. And like we couldn't enjoy our weekends and stuff as 15, 16 year old kids, you know, like,
cause we were kids. That's the thing, eh? Like it's a fine line, bro. And I think if you think of the caliber of players that Kings had, that St. Kitts had, there were some, and still to this day, bro, there's just an abundance of talent going through both schools, eh? And before we even start, bro, like, if Ty and Sis do listen to this, I just want to thank Sis for giving me that opportunity, bro, because reflecting on it, fuck, what an opportunity, man. Like, one that I'd never ever be able to experience again, but one that I'm so, so grateful for. And
100%.
I agree, bro. Like, I reckon we break it down even more so. And like, I'll ask you what a normal week would be in the St. Kitts first 15 when you were there, and I'll do the same and we'll kind of compare them. But the whole professionalism about both environments is what made them so special, bro.
Yeah, definitely.
You know what I mean? Like that's their point of difference. And that's something that I was like, fuck, this is where I need to be, because I would make any sacrifice, bro, to make sure that I played the best or prepared the best. Like I would I wouldn't drink. I wouldn't go out on the weekend. I'd be in bed at a certain time every night before. You know, like I'd sacrifice not doing my homework to be in bed early. I'd make sure that I'd eat the best food, like stuff that like All Blacks were doing.
Yeah.
Like that's the kind of mindset that I was driven in. But as a result, as a 15, 16, 17 year old, it wasn't that I wasn't allowed to be a kid, but I kind of didn't give myself that opportunity to be a kid as well. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know what you mean, bro. But like, it's just sort of, as you said as well, like there's no rainbow without a bit of rain, eh? Like you always got to have the negative side to everything. Like you can't have everything. You're right. And one word that stuck with me there was sacrifice. And like, that's what something it does teach you. Like I learned sacrifice at school. Like I learned what it meant, you know, what it took to win, what it took to be successful. Like
100%.
But at the same time, and I think this will change, like this will develop in like schools. Like I think it already has. Like I even talked to a couple of the boys when we left St. Kent's, like what their situation was like compared to ours. Way different, bro. Like way different. And they were still successful, 100%. Bro. But it's just like, and like obviously we got a drinking culture in New Zealand, and like that's not always the best thing. Like I'm not gonna say like you know, like it was bullshit that we weren't allowed to go out and drink or whatever like that. But like I think just like trying to remember, because it's hard for, you know, people to remember that, like, still kids, bro, like still actually kids. Like if I look at like my little sister, you know, my little sister is like, one of them is like, she's nearly 14, bro. And like, I think I was 14 when I played my first, I think I was 14 when I played my first 15 game or 15. Yeah. Like, and like, I look at her and I'm like, what?
I think, like, can't compare that, bro, like young boys, man. 100%. And there's a fine line there, bro. And I guess the way I always looked at it is that like I was given an opportunity to play at Kings, and that I would sacrifice anything to make sure that I was playing my best footy, bro. And I'll put my hand on my heart saying that while I was at Kings, I wasn't the player that I wanted to be. I wasn't the player that I was before I got there. I felt like my game changed a lot, bro, when I was there. But that's the thing, bro. Like, you touched on sacrifice again, but that's the thing, bro. Like, this professional environment teaches you so many things as a kid, eh?
Yeah.
But I think there was a line, and I don't think that line for us as kids was clear. You know, like, it wasn't clear, this is when you work, this is when you train hard, this is when you forget about footy, you're still with on years, you know, you're 5 seconds old, get out there and have some beers with the boys, you know, like make mistakes as kids. And for our Kings team, bro, I don't think we did that enough. I think we could have done that a lot more, and it was more so like the fact that we were anxious, like we didn't want to, like it was almost frowned upon if we went out or if we drank, or like the week before a big game or the night after a small game heading into a big game. I was like, we're anxious. Oh no, we've got Kent's coming up this week. We can't go out and drink.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, you guys are out on the piss. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
I remember one time, bro, we were, we played Sacred when George Wietana slotted that drop goal. And we lost in the last month, in our last year.
That's right.
Yeah. Gut-wrenching, bro. And then and then we played you guys the week after, and they played like Mags the week after, and Mags were the gun team that year and our last year.
Yeah.
And like, I remember all of us were, oh no, we can't get out on the post. Like, we can't, because we've got Kent's, and Kent's is one, another big game. Meanwhile, I was looking at Snapchat, bro, and I'm like, Sacred were just getting absolutely steamed, and they had Mags the next week, you know? And that's the difference, bro. Like, I reckon... to some extent, if we did the same, it would transfer onto the field, bro, because like you said, you touched on it, we've got a pretty bad drinking culture in New Zealand, but that kind of stuff builds your culture, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, like it binds a brotherhood almost.
100%,
We needed to do that more at Kings, bro, I reckon.
What
was it like at Kings? Bro, because like you and I, we came from small schools, we came to Auckland, like we're young, we're... you know, like we chased girls, like we were footy players. To a certain extent, bro, you and I wanted to get out there and party and like, because like, you know, it's a completely different environment, bro, you know, like.
Oh, you threw two young boys into a massive city like Auckland, put them at two of the most prestigious rugby schools in New Zealand, and, you know, surrounded by very wealthy people in a very wealthy community. Like, bro, it's absolutely like, you're 16 years old. Remember this. You were what, 15 when you went to to Kings? I was 16. I was year 12 when I went to St. Kent's. Bro, we're kids, bro. Like, you can't learn. You can't know that stuff properly. Like, that stuff comes later when you develop. Like,
yeah, bro, 100%.
I don't think there's anything wrong with it.
Nah, neither. Not at all. Tell us about how you transitioned, bro, from TBC to St. Kent's.
First, when it happened is, and I think I've told this on a podcast before, but like, so buzzy, but the game I got picked up, when I first had my arm with Ty, was the game when we played, I was playing for Tauranga Boys First 15, and we played Gizzy Boys on TV, and it was my first year in the First 15. And I was 15 at the time. And
bro, we played you at TBC Kings.
Yeah.
Do you remember that?
Yeah, in the preseason. And that's cursing rain.
Yeah,
holy hell. That was the worst. That was close to the worst. You know, there's the two worst games I've ever had, like, weather wise that I've played in, I reckon. One was that game.
Yeah.
And I reckon the second one was when we played you in Taranaki for Wellington.
Oh, and bro, that was terrible, eh?
That was disgusting, bro. That would and you guys worst. Didn't you guys didn't give us a score a point,
bro.
Oh yeah, man.
We didn't score a point.
But what was I saying? Oh, Tauranga Boys. So there's a big difference, obviously. I reckon one of the biggest differences I noticed too around Schoolboys, Rugby at Tauranga Boys compared to Kent's was, as Tauranga Boys, bro, it was rare to like make the first 15 at year 11. Like, you'd get one, maybe two if you're lucky from year 11 that make the firsts. Yeah. But at St. Kent's, bro, it wasn't like unusual to see year 9s or 10s playing for first 15 every weekend.
That's it, bro, because how old was Rivs when he...
Yeah, year 10. He got pulled in at year 10.
Bro, he would have notched like 50 caps easy, eh?
I don't know. Yeah, probably, bro. Like, pretty close, he played, you know, like a decent chunk of that year. But then like the 11, 12, 13, he played pretty much the whole season. So, bro, he would have notched up. But like, not just him, like so many players. And I reckon it comes down to like how they develop, you know, how they develop their players from a young age. Like,
yeah,
it's 100%. Crazy that to see, like, but it's not, I thought it was crazy to see those kind of players training with us or whatever. I remember I went to my first yo-yo test up at St. Kent's that first year I went up.
Yeah.
Oh, and that's what I was going to say before too, by the way. I didn't tell anyone that I was going, bro. So like, I went up for that test, came back, went to touch training for Touch Nationals for Tauranga Boys. I was not telling anyone, bro, because I didn't want to tell the boys that I was leaving. Because I was fuck that. Like, I don't, like, they're just going to call me a traitor and shit. And, like, you know how school boys go.
Yeah, bro.
And I went up, there.
Tapped it on the fire,
bro? Oh, the Gizzy game.
Is that the story? Yeah,
bro. Yeah, bro. First thing was, I went up to that yo-yo test and I met Riv there. That was my first time I ever met Riv. And and I was like, he looked young. And I was like, oh, what's up, bro? And he told me his name and I was like, his name. And he's like, I was like, oh, what year are you? And he's like, oh, I'm year 10. I was like, oh, year 9, because he was year 10 the next year. The year that he played was year 10. Year 9, he was like, year 9. I was like, what? It just blew my mind, bro. But, like, for them, it was normal, G, because, like, it wasn't normal, but, like, it was more normal. But, yeah, that Gizzy game. So, we played on TV, and it got to the end of the game. We were down by 1 point. We got into their fight, like, 5 metres out from their line. Time's up on the clock and we're one point down. We get a penalty. I see the advantage go up and I see everyone flat as like 5 meters out. The first thing I thought of, bro, was like 5 meter touch, you know, 5 meter touch.
See, like, I'm five, bro.
Yeah, bro. Cause like they're going to have to get back and then come forward. And the difference is they're going to have to tackle me too. So I was like, there's no way they're getting me. Like I'm as soon as he blows his whistle, I'm tapping it. I'm going
didn't even cross my mind that we were 1 point down and we're sitting right next to the post and we could have just kicked it over. I could have thrown it over for my bad hand in school and won. It blows the whistle, I tap it, I go, they tackled me straight away. Like, they didn't take one step back, bro. And I was like, fuck, but we're in Gizzy, bro. Penalty. Nah, we're in Gizzy, bro. Like, that ain't a penalty in Gizzy. Basically, I got tackled. He said, play on. And then one of the boys pick and go, another one pick and go, got held up. Turnover, game over. Camera zooms in on this little 15-year-old boy crying, and they're like, oh my God, what a mistake he's made. I was like, God, bro. I know, and gee, this is like, you know, and then I get, I think maybe, I don't know, within the next 1 or 2 weeks, I go up and see Ty, because Ciarahn, and I was like, fuck, like, he would have seen that game. Mm-hmm. Little did I know, bro, that was actually the game you watched, like, pretty much for me to go to Gens. And I like sat down with him in the foyer, bro, and he was like, saw your game a couple of weekends ago on TV. And I was like, yeah. Like, I was embarrassed, bro. And then he was like, what was going through your head in that last play? And I was like, to be honest with you, I'd like seen how flat they were, and I didn't even look at the scoreboard. I just like sort of backed myself to score it, and I just went for it, and then that was all I really had to say. And then he was like, no, I think it's good. I think you made the right choice. And I was like, oh wait, what? And he was like, those fellas were offside as fuck. Like, and I was like, oh shit, like what? And then he was like, I'm gonna tell you something that I told one of the other halfback that's here at the moment. And he was like, we played Ottawa this year or the year before. We were on a 52-game winning streak, and we were ahead, and it was the last play of the game, and he threw a cutout ball that got intercepted, and Ottawa ran full field and scored and beat St. Kent's and killed their 52 winning streak. And Ottawa at the time were like one of the bottom two or three teams in the comp, and they beat them. And obviously, the halfback was so gutted that he threw the cutout ball that got intercepted when it was they could have just kicked it out. And he said, he did this. He was gutted as in the changing rooms. I went up to him, you know, it was the first thing I told him. Don't stop throwing cutout balls. And then I was like, and he's like, do you know what I'm going to tell you? And I was like, don't stop quick tapping. And he's like, fuck, you're a quick learner. And I was like, shit. Like, I'd never seen that, bro. He was, but like, I still honestly think to this day he's probably the best coach I've ever had, G. Like, just all round, like, in terms of, like, knowing you as a person and knowing you as a player, like, you know, he's a good coach, bro. Like,
Mark, that's a cool story. That's the thing, bro. Like, if you make a mistake like that and it has that much of a consequence, you need your coach to be like, don't stop doing that. You know, like, that's the best part of your game. Keep doing that. You know what I mean? Because that's 100%. Just going to, like, it's just going to wipe your whole mentality on throwing a cutout ball. Oh, fuck, he's right. I need to keep that because that's a strong point of my game. Or it's only one mistake. It's one game. You know what I mean? Like, a coach not addressing that could literally change your whole game,
100%.
Like, I bet you would have thought twice about quick tapping ever since that game. If Ty didn't bring that up with you, you know what I mean?
Oh, bro, the boys started. My new nickname for the rest of that year was quick tap, Jay.
Quick tap. That's the thing, bro. Like, you can take the piss out of it too, and they're good at that, I reckon.
Yeah.
100%. Bro, tell us what a Monday to Saturday.
Oh, yeah. So,
what would your week look like?
Monday. Into a big game? Monday night. I'd be on the piss. Monday night we have like review. We'd have like a review and a walkthrough. Monday morning we'd have gym as well. And then Tuesday, Thursday, Friday. So I think we have Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday after school, so 4 days.
Yeah.
And then Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday before school. So we had
four after school trainings, four before school trainings a week. So four gym trainings, four after schools. Monday was like the review, and the Monday morning was like a power session or something like that. Yeah. Oh, heavy session, sorry. Tuesday was like your, you know, your heavy loading day. Thursday was like your final hit out, like still pretty heavy. Friday was captain's run, Saturday game. And so like you think about that, I was like, think about it now, like eight trainings a week for a school. And then on top of that, you go to school all day. And you, oh, uncle's falling asleep in every class. Like, bro, you used to fall asleep in school like all the time.
Bro, I was lucky enough, I had a study in my last year.
Oh, yeah.
So I only took four subjects and I'd have a study. And like the way the timetable worked is that you'd have, so after morning tea, so you'd have two study blocks before interval and then you'd have a double. So you'd have the two study blocks between interval and lunch, the same subject for 2 hours, not one. So that'll give your teacher more time with you.
Yeah.
So once your study block fell into double study, you literally could go back to the house after your second block, all through interval, double study, all through lunch, and you wouldn't have to be back in class until after lunch. Yeah, so not really, eh? I never really kind of fell asleep in class. I was too much of a goody good, bro.
Could you go back to your house like during breaks?
Yeah, bro. Oh, in year 13, you could.
That's me.
Yeah, year 11, year 12, not so much. But bro, in my last year, it just so happened to be that predominantly all of us year 13, first 15 boys all had a study and it was all in the same block. So we'd like all go back to like one boarding house. It'd be like maybe 8 or 9 of us and we'll either all just watch, I don't know, TV or talk shit or...
Yeah.
That was cool, but I'd play PlayStation or something like that.
Fuck, we had studies as well and we had like, one morning a week, you'd have like a double study and like you wouldn't start school until after morning tea. That's so still dope. Falling asleep. So I don't know. That works,
bro, I remember, like, bro, I'll tell you a funny story is like before I actually went to King's and I fell in love with it, I actually wanted to go to St. Kent's, eh?
True.
Yeah, I've talked to Bev about it before. Well, this would have been a couple of years ago now, but... because at the time, Puds had gone from Tutor, and obviously Beb had gone as well.
Yeah.
And like, we're all busting ass at Tutor, just wanting to get scholarships to big schools. And like, no other school but St. Kent's kind of intrigued me, only because Puds and that were there.
Yeah, right, yeah.
And I was like, St. Kent's would be so cool, man. Like, I remember Eddie's dad, Futsu. We were up in Auckland. We played Wesley, our Tutor second 15, and he took us to the St. Kent's facility. And I remember going into like that little hallway thing, but like you look down and you've got like the basketball court in there.
Yeah.
When you look over the top.
Little bridge. Bro,
I was, I was blown away, bro. I was like, holy
shit. Have you seen the new gym, bro?
This is the place. Nah.
You should see what they have there now. It is like, I went back and had a look. I think it was last year, bro. I could not believe it, G. I was like, this is like better than, you know, like most sporting facilities, like, and gym when it's at a school. Gym, full size gym in like a warehouse almost, bro. It is massive, G.
Actually, yeah, bro. I remember just going there. This is before I even knew, like, I was going to go to King's. And just looking at it, bro, I was like, this is where I want to be, you know, like, and I remember having like King's and St. Kent's. So Ty and Sess were both at that tournament. And I was like, fuck, Kent's would be the place, man. Like, that was cool. And then I went to Kingsbury and just instantly fell in love with it. I was like, nah, this is me, 100%. Because your week was pretty similar to ours, bro. So, like, Monday morning would have gym, and then Monday afternoon would have, like, a review of the last game, and then a preview of the next game. And then maybe if we're bringing in something new, we'd go out on the field and just go over that. Tuesday morning, you'd have gym and then a field session. Wednesday, all of Wednesday would be off. So after school, Wednesday, I'd just go and do some kicking. Yeah. Thursday morning, gym. Thursday afternoon, pretty much your last field session. Friday, sleeping. And then Friday after school, captain's run. And Saturday, play. But like, have you heard of Wally Rifle, bro?
No.
So he was... he was our trainer at the time. Real good guy, bro. And he was like ex-Blues trainer and stuff.
Yep.
And he's real big on like getting your load under your legs and stuff. So like, heaps of running. And at the time, bro, we had GPS. Like, what are they called again? VX Sport.
Yeah, GPS.
Or at school. At school, we were wearing GPSs.
Oh, that's bad, bro.
Yeah, and like we were getting tracked with how many meters we were running at a certain speed, which governed how much training we would do and governed how much running after training we would do to make sure that we were like theoretically in a good spot leading into the game.
Yeah.
So like it would come up to us at the end of the training, he'd be like, oh, Ciarahn, you have 2 100s to do. So-and-so, you have 4, you have 5, you have 1. You know, like that's how detailed we were in our training, bro. And like, would have bibs, would have our GPS. He'd be there tracking it, like at training, bro. He'd be tracking it on his iPad and stuff.
Yeah.
And then we're hot shading the ice baths after training. Oh, bro, it was like next level, way. But that's, it was so cool, bro. It was cool. And like towards our last year, have you been in the you've been in the visitors' change rooms at Kings Lane
under
the pavilion?
Yeah.
So imagine that, but like just heaps of cool inspirational photos and shit around the edges, bro. And then like they made like cubby holes, bro, like you know the ones at Eden Park.
Yeah
They made cubby holes,
bro. Oh, that's so mean.
Yeah, it was dope. Fuck, it was cool, man. So cool, bro.
Alright, G, I've got a few things to do, so we'll wrap it up there. But good to check you on, my man. And
yeah, bro, 100%.
Thanks for your time again, and we'll jump back on and we have another yarn about some other stuff, eh? Go for a bit longer.
Yeah, keen, bro. There's plenty to talk about.
Sweet, brother. Good to chat, brother.
Thanks for having me on, eh?
Take care, bro.
You too, brother.
See you.